There's only one way to get better at something, and that's by practicing it over and over. So I'm going to take you through some Postgres drills to get a little better at Postgres. Let's get into it. As a warm-up, create a database that has a one-to-many relationship across two tables. I'm going to use posts and comments, but feel free to spice it up a bit and do something different. Just make sure that one row from one table can reference any number of rows from another. Okay, pause the video here and see if you can implement it on your own. So to step through the solution, I could teach you how to actually do this, but instead I'm going to teach you how to cheat because it's much faster. If you're using Supabase, you can click this button to open up this AI assistant where we can ask a question about our SQL query. So I'm going to say, create a table for posts and one for comments. These tables should have a one-to-many relationship and insert some example data. So this column is looking a little cramped, so we can come up to the top here and click here to insert code into the SQL editor, and then we can scroll up to the top here to close this assistant. And we always want to verify the output before executing, so we can see this is creating a table for posts with an ID, title, content, and created at. We could make this column default to the result of calling the now function, so we don't actually need to pass across a value for created at, and we can add an additional column for is underscore published, which will be a boolean. We don't ever want this column to be null, and we want it to default to the value false. We also want our title to not be nullable, and we'll just fix the case for this content column. Everything else looks pretty good. We have an ID. It's a big int, so we'll be able to store an insanely large number of blogs in this table. This is also our primary key. It's automatically generated for us, and we're using it to identify our post table. And then for our comments table, we have the same kind of ID. We have the ID for the post that this comment belongs to, and that's what makes this a one-to-many relationship between posts and comments. Every post can have many comments, and every comment belongs to a particular post. And we always want a comment to have a post, so we can actually set this column to be not null. And then down here, we can see that this is setting up a foreign key relationship between our posts ID column in this comments table and then the posts table's ID. So every comment will now need a post ID, and that post ID will have to match one of the IDs in our post table. We also have the comment text, which we also probably don't want to be null, and a created at timestamp, which we also want to default to the result of calling the now function. We're then inserting some example posts. Again, we need to change the case for this content column, and we don't actually need to specify a value for that created at column because it's automatically going to be set to when we created that new post, but we could set the is underscore published column so that the first post is published and the second post is not published. We then have our example comments, which look good, but again, we don't need to specify that created at timestamp. We can get rid of each of these, and we can run this one to create our post table, our comments table, and populate them with some example data. Okay, great warm up. Let's get into the drills. Write a select statement that gets all of the posts and then a big comma separated string of all of the comments for that particular post. Something like this. So you should only have one row per post, and all of the comments for that post should only be in one column. So pause this one here and give it a go yourself. Now go on, give it a go. It's a really good way to get these drills to sink in. All right, fine. Let's just step through the solution. So firstly, we want to select all of the columns from the post table, and we can run this one just to see that we are indeed getting back all of our posts. So now we just need to append on our column that contains all of the comments for each of these posts. So we can do this a couple of different ways. We could use a join, or more specifically a left join, to bring in the columns from the comments table, or we could use a subquery to select something else or generate some value that we want. I prefer to use the subquery because really we're constructing our own formatted column, but you can use whichever one you would prefer. So back to our example, we're selecting all of the columns from posts, and then we want to use a subquery to generate this new formatted column, and we can alias this to comments. So this will be the column's name in the result set, and then our subquery is going to select the text underscore content column from the comments table where the comments.post underscore ID column is equal to the posts.id id that we're currently selecting all of the columns for. Now, if we run this statement, we're going to get an error, but not the error I was expecting. And that's because we have not used the correct column name. It should be comment underscore text. So let's change this to comment underscore text. Now, if we give this a run, we'll still get an error, but the error that I was expecting, where there is more than one row returned by a subquery used as an expression. And that's totally fair because there are multiple comments for each of our blogs. So let's aggregate them together or concatenate them into one single string. And to do that, we can wrap this column that we're selecting from the comments table in a call to the string underscore AGG or aggregate function. We then pass it the column that we want to aggregate and then what we want to use as a separator. So in this case, let's have a comma and a space. And now if we give this query a run, we'll see the exact result set we're looking for, where we have all of the columns from our post table and then an aggregated column of each of our comments that have been left on that specific post. We can also insert a third post that doesn't have any comments so that we can see what that aggregated column looks like if we don't have any comments. So for our first and second post, we have those aggregated comments. And since our third post doesn't have any comments, it's just the value null. And that's our first drill done. Awesome. Now this works, but it's likely that our application will want to display a little bit more than just a comma separated string of all of the comments. Probably a nicely formatted list of cards that have the contents of the comment, when it was published and by whom, if we actually had that in our schema. So let's aggregate all of the columns together from the comments table into a big JSON blob. So something like this, where we still only have one row for each of our posts, but then the comments column is a big JSON blob that contains all of the columns from our comments table. So pause the video here and give it a go. Why aren't you pausing the video? Just pause the video, just do it. Okay, fine. The solution is, rather than using the string aggregate function, we want to use the JSON aggregate function. We then pass it the full comments row, and then we don't need a separator. Now, if we give this a run, we'll see our three posts and our comments column is now a big JSON array of each of the columns from the comments table. We could also refactor this one to use joins rather than a subquery and get exactly the same result. Now, knowing how to restructure a query to use a join instead of a subquery and vice versa can be super handy. If you need a little bit more practice, then you should totally check out this video right here. We write a complex query across three different tables using nested selects and then refactor this to use joins instead. Now, if you're ready for the next Postgres topic, check out this playlist. But until next time, keep building cool stuff.